We're live tonight from the marina in Venice, Louisiana. It is a gritty, gorgeous fishing village. Many of those boats you're seeing right there, unfortunately, sadly idled by the Gulf oil spill. The water is now close to fishing, the livelihood of this community in question tonight. We're back continuing our conversation with the president of this parish, Billy Nungesser, and also joining us from New Orleans, our CNN contributor and New Orleans resident, James Carville. I was had a conversation with the governor during this trip, and he says one of his bigger questions, they don't know how much oil is spewing in, they don't know how much has been in the water, they can't get questions about the response quick enough. He says looking down the road, one of the questions he keeps asking, what is in those dispersants they're using to try to break up the oil to keep it from shore, but the question is, what will those chemicals do to the water? What will those chemicals do to the sea life? The governor was very frustrated.
We need to see the ingredients. We need to see the concentrations. We need to know what to test for in our seafood. We need to know a year from now, 2 years from now, 5 years from now, what to be looking for and what these chemicals are doing. At first, they wouldn't give us the ingredients. Now they want us to sign a non-disclosure list, non-disclosure agreement. We're fighting that, saying our people have a right to know what chemicals are out there and what concentrations.
Doesn't the public have a right to know?
Absolutely. Our people, the public, has an absolute right to know what's being put in that water, and so that we can know, we have some guarantee of what to test for and how to protect ourselves.
Do you know? I mean, do you know what to tell these guys about, will you be able to fish in 5 weeks or five
Absolutely.
Years?
Absolutely. You see that orange coming in, that's not just oil. Right. And, you know, it was going to stay offshore, they were going to spray offshore. Well, that orange coming in, the BP representative that went out with us said, you can see the dispersants is in this, it's not in that. It's in this, it's not in that. So he was identifying it right there off our coast. So it has made it to the breeding grounds. So we won't know, and they won't disclose it. That's criminal. The federal government ought to demand that they disclose everything. And we're still spraying it. And I personally think it's causing more problems because it's keeping the oil stable. It's hot in the oil. If they didn't spray anything, it all came to the top. We could capture it all and lift it out. It's like they did it to hide the oil, just like I believe they don't want to know how much oil is coming out.
Because they pay based on how much oil is coming out.
I got to believe that.
Hey, James, what does it tell you when the governor of your state says, I can't tell my health department, you know, what to test for in the seafood, what to test for in the water supply, what to put on a list so that we check back in 6 months, 2 years, 5 years, or whatever, to make sure there's not a long-term impact?
Well, the manufacturer that dispersant, it claims time and time again that they have given the ingredients and that they're utterly harmless. The people at Tulane at environmental school said the dispersant is harmless. I know that Lisa Jackson, who's the EPA administrator, is from here. She's a highly trained engineer. I don't think she would do something that would harm, but you know, we don't have the research on what this dispersant effect on seafood is. We need it, but it's important to note that there is another side to this story in terms of how harmful this dispersant is. Myself, I have utterly no idea. I'm not trained in this kind of thing. But I do know that the Tulane environmental people, who I suspect are pretty skilled, seem to think this stuff is not as dangerous as some people do. But it's something that needs to be discussed, it needs to be aired out, and we got to hear every side of this issue.
Sunlight, as we say, the more public information we have, the less questions and the less debate. James and Billy will be back with us in just a bit. We want you now to consider this. The dispersants issue also matters when people talk about that long-term habitat, not just for the fishermen, but for the species that live there. Here are some pictures of endangered sea turtles taken right from the oily waters. The immediate priority is to save their lives, but the scientists doing that also have some troubling long-term questions.
So we do have teams out in the Gulf, both shoreline as well as in open water. They're actively trying to find the animals as quickly as they can.
Well, this is the area where the oiled turtles will come into. They get their initial exam.
How dirty was he when you got him?
105. They cleaned him up on the boat very, very well, so was not bad.
We've collected 35 live oiled turtles to date. We then bring them into rehabilitation, care for them long term, make sure they're as healthy as they can be.
And so this was a 136-pound loggerhead when it came in.
Yes.
When will you know?
We're doing regular exams to make sure all the oil is out of her system. When she's healthy, when she's as normal as we think she's going to be, we're then going to return them. Most of these turtles are being flown to Florida to be released into a clean environment. But timing is very bad for sea turtles in particular. Right now, females are coming up to lay eggs. This was one of the turtles that was caught actually out on the water.
What do you look for in the first couple days to get a sense of whether they have anything chronic?
Well, we're testing their blood. Some of these turtles have come into us with low blood glucose, so they're not eating real well.
What's in their food?
That's an excellent question. We don't We know that oil is out there. It's going to be taken up in the food chain. We know that there's going to be long-term exposure of turtles, mammals, and birds to oil on an ongoing basis.
What about during the efforts out there now when all the dispersants are being dropped? Are they as much a threat as the oil?
They can be. We don't have a lot of information as far as the effects of dispersant and dispersed oil on these species.
You have experience going back to Valdez. Put this spill into context in terms of the scope of the damage.
We have over 150 people out there actually caring for the animals and trying to capture them. So just the sheer vastness of the response is very different.
I mean, when do you think you'll be comfortable saying, you know, here's what happened?
I think it's going to take a long time because there's so much oil in the environment. Because the oil's been dispersed undersea, there's a large volume in the water. I think we're going to know, as far as the acute effects, how many animals died, how many animals were collected. But as far as the long-term population level effects, we're still learning some of the effects from Exxon Valdez even today. Right. So I do think it might even take decades in this spill.
Just a remarkable effort there, and they deserve our praise and our support as they try to save all this wildlife. Coming up in Wall to Wall, telling BP, show me the money. We'll have the latest on their payment of claims and possibly cutting their dividends. Also, we'll go one-on-one with the Mississippi Governor, Haley Barbour. He says something President Obama's planning has him tickled to death. Friday is the day you get to make your case. What message do you have for the people of the Gulf and BP? And in the play-by-play, we've heard from all four Gulf governors during our tour this week. What do they have in common? Where do they disagree? And you've got to hear the viral remix of President Obama kicking A. I saw your friend Governor Jindal here yesterday in Louisiana. He was white hot at the president. He says the president, with this deep water moratorium, is now adding an economic catastrophe on top of an environmental catastrophe for the Gulf region. But the White House says, look, we don't know what caused the spill on the Deepwater Horizon, and until we can study it, until we can find out what new safety precautions might be necessary, what new regulations might be necessary, the president says he's not going to take the risk. Who's right?
Well, I agree with Governor Jindal. This is not a question where it's all the rights on one side. The president, I know, believes he's being prudent. But look, when an airplane crashes, we don't shut down the airlines until we figure out why it crashed. And this is the first time in 30-plus thousand drillings that this has happened. And it's a terrible thing, and we need to get to the bottom of it. But I do not believe we need to stop all drilling. And I'll tell you why. It's more than just jobs lost in the Gulf region, though it'll be terrible. It'll be a huge economic negative impact. And the idea that these oil rigs, 33 of them that were out there drilling wells in deep water, are going to sit around here for 6 months during this moratorium and then be here to start drilling, and the idea that we're only going to lose 6 months of drilling is just wrong-headed. Those oil wells, those oil drilling rigs are going to be off West Africa, Indonesia, China, Brazil, Russia. They'll be all over the world because they are so, so expensive. They're not going to let them idle. And frankly, as you know, John, the two big companies here that are involved in this spill, BP and Transocean, are not even American companies. They don't feel compelled to stay in America. They're going to go wherever the business is. And some of these rigs won't come back for years and years. The 10 worst oil spills in American history, one was from an oil well, 7 were from ships carrying oil at sea. We'd have more ships carrying oil at sea because of this moratorium.
The president is coming to your state next week with Mississippi. You have tensions with the president right now? Do you not want to be photographed with him?
No. Look, when George Bush came to the Gulf Coast many, many times after Katrina, I never went to see him unless he came to Mississippi. I certainly didn't have any issues with George Bush. And I got no problem with President Obama. We're tickled to death he's coming Monday. He has known that the red carpet was out for whenever he wanted to come. I candidly understand why he went the first 3 times to Louisiana. It is a huge, huge, huge different problem over there from what we got.